Since you're here for a lecture, and as it doesn't seem fair to ask anybody else at very short notice to speak to you, it's going to be me. Now, as I'd like Brother Lloyd to deliver his message at some time, he did indicate when he emailed me this morning that he would try to get across sometime in the future at least an audio version of what he wanted to say. So I'm not going to speak on his or any of the other I Am topics in the programme. So what I have in mind won't fit exactly with the theme, but it is about the Lord Jesus personally, which is where we wanted the emphasis to be in this series of lectures. The Lord Jesus is given and gives himself many different names and titles in the scriptures. And I want to consider one of these titles here. All the names and titles that the Lord Jesus has have meaning, of course. They're directly relevant to him, unlike the names and titles that our parents give us, usually anyway. The title I have in mind, I'll tell you what it is in a minute. The title I have in mind is used in the New Testament exclusively for the Lord Jesus Christ and almost exclusively by him. Every time this title is used in the Gospels, it's used by the Lord himself, except on just one occasion. And that was one occasion was when the people were speaking back to him about what he had said about himself. So we can say that essentially the title is used in the Gospels by the Lord himself only and as a title for himself. The title is used by one of the early believers in the Acts. We find it once in the New Testament letters, where it appears in a quotation from the Old Testament, and it occurs twice in Revelation in a slightly different form. Okay. And every time we're talking about the Lord Jesus himself. Well, most of you have probably worked out what it is. It is the Son of Man. So how do we understand this title, the Son of Man? So the Lord Jesus calls himself the Son of Man. Now, if we were to consider this in a very simple way, this title might really surprise us. There are only two men who've ever lived on this earth who did not literally have a male human being as their father. And the Lord Jesus was one of them. But he does take that title for himself, the Son of Man. So why is he the Son of Man? Okay, so let's talk about the phrase son of. We find in the Gospels son of used sometimes when noting a characteristic of a person or a group of people. The Lord Jesus often used this phrase himself. We learn from him of the sons of the kingdom, the sons of the wicked one, the sons of this world, the sons of light, sons of resurrection, the sons of this age. James and John were sons of thunder. Judas Iscariot was the son of perdition. So when the term son of something is used, that something characterizes the person so described in some important way. The Lord Jesus, as the Son of Man, partakes of the characteristics of manhood. He's a real human being, but without sin, of course. He became a man, but not by human generation. So in the record we have of the life of the Lord Jesus on this earth, we find him giving himself this title more often, I believe, than any other. He calls himself the Son of Man more often than he calls himself the Son of God. He calls himself the Son of Man more often than he calls himself the Son of David, or the Christ, or Jesus, or any other name or title that belongs to him. It's a title the Lord Jesus used of himself. And as I've said, it's almost true that only he used it. About 80 times in the Gospels, he refers to himself as the Son of Man. So we'll try and see what the significance of this title is. The only time in the Gospels when anyone other than the Lord Jesus Christ himself refers to the Son of Man is found in John chapter 12 and verse 34, where the people ask the Lord, who is this Son of Man, responding to the Lord Jesus speaking about himself. They may not even have realized that they're actually talking to the Son of Man. Who is this Son of Man? So the disciples and us too could be in no doubt who this Son of Man is, that the Lord Jesus was actually referring to himself when he talked about the Son of Man. We read in Matthew 16:13 of him asking the disciples, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? I, the Son of Man, he said. Okay, we'll come back to the Lord Jesus as the Son of Man in the Gospel shortly, but let's go to the Old Testament. There are three important Old Testament prophecies that have a bearing on this subject. In two of these prophecies, we read of the Son of Man. In the other, one like a Son of Man. These three prophecies all clearly refer to the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's have a look at them. The first is in Psalm 8. Okay, from verse 3. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have ordained, what is man that you're mindful of him, and the Son of Man that you visit him? For you have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor. You have made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. You've put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, even the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea that pass through the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Now, I don't know whether the Jews who read this understood it as a prophecy or whether they simply took it as saying that mankind has been given a position over creation, but lower than the angels. Yes, Adam was given dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth, we're told in Genesis 1. But as we know, he failed. God created Adam and put him in a perfect environment where he could live to the full in a way that would please God and bring glory to him, where he could have communion with God. Everything was set for Adam and Eve to live in contentment and happiness. They could have freely chosen to obey God and to keep this place, but they didn't. They were tempted by Satan. They directly and knowingly disobeyed God and threw these wonderful privileges away. Yeah, their disobedience to God broke the communion with God. It separated them from God. God, being holy, can't accept sin. It's abhorrent to him. He can't have anything to do with it. Sin cut Adam off from God. It destroyed the communion he had with God. It forced him out of his perfect environment into a world of pain and suffering. So that's what happened to the first man because he sinned. And we all, of course, have this sinful nature as part of us. We're told that we're born in sin. But God had another man in view. Whatever the Jews' understanding of this psalm, the Holy Spirit, through the writer to the Hebrews, links this passage with the Lord Jesus. So let's just read that from Hebrews 2. So Hebrews chapter 2, verse 5, it says, "For he has not put the world to come of which we speak in subjection to angels, but one testified in a certain place, saying, what is man that you're mindful of him, or the Son of Man that you take care of him? You have made him a little lower than the angels. You've crowned him with glory and honor and set him over the works of your hands. You've put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he's left nothing that is not put under him. But now we do not yet see all things put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone." So Jesus made a little lower than the angels. The Son of God, he became a man. He took on human form. He was made in the likeness of men. Now, this shouldn't need saying, but to make sure that we're all clear about it, he is divine. He is God. He did not divest himself of deity when he became a man. He is truly God and became truly man. Jesus, the Son of God, God the Son, became a human being. We should meditate on this wonderful truth, shouldn't we? It's fundamental and it's astonishing. Jesus was the creator of the universe. All things were made by him, we're told. He made man, yet he became a man. He humbled himself, laying aside the glory and splendor he had as God to become a man. He put it aside so that he could be born in humility in a cattle shed. He came into this world as a baby. This is truly amazing. Now, every statement that the Lord Jesus made as the Son of Man, every statement made about him as the Son of Man, has behind it that truth that he is human. He entered the human race. That's fundamental to all that he says and all that's said about him as the Son of Man, his humanness. Yeah? I prefer to use the word humanness to the word humanity. I mean, I hope humanness is a word. If not, we'll pretend it is. I prefer it to the word humanity because the word humanity does not generally, when used now, doesn't generally mean being human. In contemporary English, really, it's more to do with being humane. But when we speak here of the Lord Jesus, we're talking about the truth that the Lord Jesus was truly a human being. So I'm going to use the word humanness. So back here in Hebrews 2, he is the Son of Man. There's something else noticeable here too. The psalmist and the writers of the Hebrews look back at him on this earth, a little lower than the angels, but they also look at him now, crowned with glory and honor, the position that the Son of Man, Christ Jesus, now holds. He's crowned with glory and honor. And the Hebrew author looks at him in the future. We do not yet see all things put under him, but the time will come when God will put all things in subjection to him. So we have the past, the present, and the future of the Son of Man in that short passage. It's rich with truth. Okay, the second Old Testament reference I want us to consider also comes from the Psalms. And it's Psalm 80. In this psalm, Asaph is calling on the Lord God to save Israel. We see in verse 4 that God was angry with Israel. They suffered. They were fed with the bread of tears. And verse 5 tells us they had tears to drink in great measure. In verses 3 and 7, we see this plea, restore us, O God, cause your face to shine on us, and we shall be saved. Verses 8 to 13, we see some of the history of God's people, Israel, brought out of Egypt into the land that God was giving them. They filled the land, they spread out. The psalm would seem to refer to the time during the early years of Solomon's reign when Israel ruled from the Mediterranean Sea to the river Euphrates. And then because of the people's rebellion against God, the Lord allowed enemies to encroach and conquer, reducing Israel's control, their power, their prosperity. The psalmist cries out to the Lord God again, asking him to visit them in verse 14. And then I want to read verses 17 and 18 of this psalm. So Psalm 80, verse 17, let your hand be upon the man of your right hand, upon the Son of Man, whom you made strong for yourself. Then we will not turn back from you. Revive us, and we will call upon your name. So the psalmist calls for the man of your right hand and the Son of Man, who you made strong for yourself. The Lord Jesus is the man of God's right hand, and he is the Son of Man. He's the one who God had promised to send. He's God's anointed one. He's the Messiah. And he has sent him, but he was rejected. However, the time will come when the Son of Man will come back. He will return to this earth. And verse 18, there will be fulfilled. And the Lord Jesus rules in the millennium. Then the faithful in Israel will call upon his name, and he will not turn, and they will not turn back from him. Okay, the third Old Testament reference I want to mention comes from the prophecy of Daniel, Daniel chapter 7. Okay, so Daniel saw a vision. There's a description of four great world empires. They can be clearly identified as the Babylonian, the Persian, the Greek, and the Roman empires. And they're described in the first 8 verses of Daniel 7. Now, looking at verse 13, I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory in the kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed. He sees in this vision one like a Son of Man, and to him was given dominion, glory, and a kingdom. Psalm 80 was very focused on Israel. The Son of Man would rescue his earthly people. But here in Daniel, the scope of this prophecy is much wider. It's universal. It links the Son of Man with all people. Many prophecies in the Old Testament are concerned in the first place with God's chosen race, the Israelites. This prophecy of the Son of Man is for all people on earth. All peoples, nations, and languages will serve him. So we mentioned three Old Testament references, prophecies concerning the Son of Man. So in the first, in Psalm 8, there seem to be three emphases. There's the humanness of the Son of Man, that he become human. Then secondly, there's his place now, crowned with glory and honor. And thirdly, we see in the future his rule as a man of creation, his dominion over creation, with his glory and the subjection of all peoples to him being mentioned. In Psalm 80, there's an emphasis on the Son of Man's coming in for Israel. And in the third prophecy in Daniel, we see his coming again to this earth. We see him be given dominion and having the rule over all peoples. Now, as we've noted, the Lord Jesus many times referred to himself as the Son of Man. In doing so, he was essentially stating that he's the fulfillment of these prophecies. And that's made clear by the Lord Jesus in Luke 18:31, where we read that he took the disciples aside to tell them, "We're going up to Jerusalem, and all things that are written by the prophets concerning who? Not concerning the Messiah, but concerning the Son of Man, all these things will be accomplished. All things concerning the Son of Man that were written by the prophets will be accomplished." The Jewish leaders should have understood the title, the Son of Man. They should have known what he was talking about. They should have known that he was claiming to be the fulfillment of the Old Testament when he used this title. And there is evidence that on at least one occasion they did have some understanding of what he was talking about. We'll mention that in passing later. Now, when we look at the times where the Lord Jesus refers to himself as the Son of Man, we see, I think, the force of these prophecies come out. Firstly, that he was a man, his humanness. Secondly, that he's now crowned with glory and honor. Thirdly, that he will come again in glory. And fourthly, that he will rule over the earth. He will have dominion. Okay. But there are also other truths brought out by the Lord Jesus when he refers to himself as the Son of Man. While recently looking at this wonderful title for the Lord Jesus, I listed all the references in the New Testament where he is the Son of Man. Using a computer, this is very easy to do. There are about 80 in the Gospels and just a few others. And I try classifying them into groups. So these are the groups I put them into. Pretty well all of the Lord's statements as Son of Man fairly easily fit into one of these groups. Okay. First group is the deity of the Son of Man. Second group, the purpose of the Son of Man in coming to this earth. Third group, the life of the Son of Man here on earth. Fourthly, the near future for the Son of Man. So his betrayal, suffering, death, resurrection. Fifthly, where the Son of Man is now. Sixthly, the Son of Man coming again, his judging and his ruling. And seventhly, our relationship with the Son of Man, the so what part for us. Now, we know that seven is a special number. It's the number of completeness, but I don't think there's any significance in my finding seven groups here. So I intend talking about the times when the Lord Jesus talks about himself as the Son of Man by considering them in these seven groupings. Of course, we can only mention a few of these 80 or so scriptures as we talk about what the Lord Jesus says about himself as the Son of Man. So firstly, the deity of the Son of Man. He is the Son of Man, a human being. But the Lord Jesus makes it clear that he's divine. He is God. There's an incident recorded in the Synoptic Gospels. So, for example, in Mark chapter 2, Mark 2 verse 10 would be the relevant verse, where the Lord Jesus forgave the sins of a paralyzed man. The scribes and Pharisees reasoned that he was blaspheming, as only God can forgive sins. The Lord Jesus said to them, "That you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins," and he healed the man. Now, only God can forgive sins, that's true. But the Son of Man has power to forgive sins. The Son of Man is human. He's a real human being, but he's also divine. he is God. And this statement of his to the scribes and Pharisees makes that totally clear. On another occasion, when the religious leaders criticized the disciples for plucking heads of grain and eating them on the Sabbath day, the Lord Jesus pointed out that the Sabbath was given for the benefit of man, and that he, the Son of Man, was Lord of that day. He was the Creator God, so he was Lord of the Sabbath that he'd instituted. So we find that in Matthew 12 and in the other Synoptic Gospels. When talking to Nicodemus, the Lord Jesus said that he is the Son of Man, which is in heaven, John 3, verse 13. Even while here below, he was the Son of Man, which is in heaven. He came down from heaven, yet he was in heaven. In becoming human, he came down from heaven, yet he never ceased to be God who is in heaven. This is beyond our understanding, isn't it? But the Son of Man is God. He is divine. Okay, so that's the first of my seven classifications. Here's the second. Why did he come as Son of Man? The Lord Jesus describes several purposes in his coming to this earth as Son of Man, as a human being. He tells us of several purposes in his coming. All of these statements he makes deserve reflection, meditation, and much more could be said about them, but time is limited. So in Mark 10, verse 45, he tells us that the Son of Man came to serve. Astonishing. The creator of the universe, he came to serve. Luke 19, verse 10 tells us the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. He came to seek and to save us. Lost through rebellion against God, he came to seek us out and save us. Mark 10:45 again tells us how he would save us, that the Son of Man came to give his life as a ransom for many. So the Lord Jesus describes these purposes in coming, and he describes these purposes when he calls himself the Son of Man. And in doing so, he is emphasizing his humanness. He could only seek and save us because he was truly human as well as truly divine. He could only be a ransom for many, a ransom for us by giving his life, by dying, which he could only do being a human being. Okay, so my third classification, the Lord Jesus describes his life here on earth under the title of the Son of Man. I'm splitting this into two subsections. Firstly, the Son of Man was God's perfect man. In John 6:27, we see that God the Father set his seal on the Son of Man. He was sealed by the Father, the Holy Spirit. In his life here on earth, the Lord Jesus showed himself to be God's perfect man. In John 13:31, at the Last Supper, just after Judas Iscariot had gone out, the Lord Jesus, anticipating what was about to befall him, said, "Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him." God is glorified in the Son of Man. Throughout his life, God was glorified in him. Jesus was that perfect human being. We know that all he did was as God wanted it, and all he did brought glory to God. God himself had testified at the Lord's baptism and at his transfiguration that he was well pleased with him. Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. Glory is manifested excellence, excellence that's shown, God's excellence was shown in that beautiful life of the Lord Jesus here. God's excellence, God's glory was shown in Christ's death too. The human race descended from Adam had all failed, but the Son of Man didn't. He was God's perfect man here. So my second subsection regarding the Son of Man's life here on earth, I'll call the Son of Man was an outsider. Okay, in Luke 9:58, the Lord Jesus tells us that the Son of Man had nowhere to lay his head. In his life as a man here, there was no home. There was no real rest for him. We also learn from Matthew 11:19 that he was a friend of outcasts. The Lord Jesus said, "The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, 'Look, a glutton and a wine bibber, a friend of tax collectors and sinners.'" The first part of the accusation was wrong, but the second part was right. He was friend of the outcast, not condoning their sinful behaviour, of course, but he was a friend to those society didn't want. The Son of Man was rejected by the religious leaders and eventually not wanted by the ordinary people either. But many of the outcasts accepted him, in fact. The Son of Man, He was God's perfect man, but he was an outcast and rejected by those he created. Okay, so my fourth grouping is near future. So his betrayal, suffering, death, resurrection. So we come to events here that hadn't yet happened when he was speaking, but would happen shortly. The Lord Jesus knew what the near future held out for him: betrayal, suffering, death, but then his resurrection. The Lord Jesus often spoke of his betrayal, suffering, death, and resurrection. And in talking about them many times, he spoke of himself as the Son of Man. Just a couple of examples. Mark 10:33. Behold, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and to the scribes. They will condemn him to death and deliver him to the Gentiles. Luke 9:22. The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised the third day. And there are many more times in Matthew, Mark, and Luke where he tells the disciples that he, as Son of Man, would go through betrayal, sufferings, death, and then be raised from the dead. These events could only happen, of course, because he is human. He is a man. Okay, so fifthly, where is he now? When the Lord Jesus was being tried by the elders of the people, the chief priests and the scribes, he said to them, "Hereafter, the Son of Man will sit on the right hand of the power of God." And they seemed to have some understanding of what this meant and replied, "Are you then the Son of God?" And the Lord politely said yes to them. Again, the Lord emphasizes that the Son of Man, the true human, is the Son of God, divine. Then the Lord Jesus said, "Hereafter, the Son of Man will sit on the right hand of the power of God." Hereafter, that means from now. From now, the Son of Man will sit on the right hand of the power of God. The Son of Man is sitting now at the right hand of the power of God. He's the man at God's right hand. Peter writes in his first letter, chapter 3, verse 22, he writes that he's gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers having been made subject to him. We saw this in Psalm 8, as explained in Hebrews 2, referring to the Lord Jesus as the Son of Man. "You've crowned him with glory and honor," Hebrews 2, verse 7, that is. The Son of Man is there at God's right hand now. Okay, so my sixth grouping of the Son of Man references in the Gospels: Son of Man coming again, his judging and his ruling. Many times when the Lord Jesus refers to himself as the Son of Man, many times what he says is associated with his return to this earth in glory to judge. We learn from the words of the Lord Jesus that as the Son of Man, he will come in glory. He will come in his own glory and the glory of his Father, he tells us in Luke 9:26. In Mark 8:38, he says he will come with the angels. All the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see him as the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. The Lord tells us in Matthew 24, verse 30. His coming will be unexpected. "The Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect," the Lord said, Matthew 24, 44. "It will be sudden. As the lightning comes from the east and flashes to the west, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be," Matthew 24, 27. So the return of the Son of Man will be an extraordinary, shocking, sudden, stunning event for the whole earth. And then we find that when he as the Son of Man comes, then he will sit on the throne of his glory, Matthew 25, 31. And because he's Son of Man, because he's the Son of Man, he's been given authority to execute judgment. The Lord tells us in John 5, 27, he as the Son of Man will judge the people of the nations, separating the sheep from the goats. See that in Matthew 25, verses 31 to 46. Consistently, all that the Lord Jesus says about his coming again as the Son of Man and what he'll do then are not connected with his return for the church. None of these statements concerning his return as Son of Man refer to what's often called the rapture, when the Lord Jesus comes back for the church, for us, to take us to be with him forever. Rather, when speaking of his return as the Son of Man, he's always speaking of his coming in glory at the end of the tribulation period. And these many references to his return in glory and judging and his millennial rule can be considered as fulfilling the Old Testament scriptures that refer to him as the Son of Man. So let's just remind ourselves of these as the background to what the Lord Jesus said. So in Psalm 8, verse 6, it says, "You've made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. You've put all things under his feet." So that's his millennial rule. Psalm 80, verses 17 and 18 say, "Let your hand be upon the man of your right hand, upon the Son of Man, who you made strong for yourself. Then we will not turn back from you. Revive us, and we will call upon your name." His rescuing and reviving of Israel, his earthly people at his return. And then from Daniel chapter 7, "I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like," it should really be "a Son of Man." There isn't a definite article there. "But coming with the clouds of heaven, he came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which will not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed." So that's very clearly his rule over all nations. Okay, now my last grouping, seventh grouping for the statements that the Lord Jesus made about himself as the Son of Man. And this is to do with our relationship with the Son of Man. We've noted that the Son of Man is now sitting at the right hand of God. And the truth is this, we do have to do with him here and now. We have dealings with him as the Son of Man. In John 6, the Lord Jesus talks about himself as the bread of life and about him as Son of Man feeding us. So verse 7 of John 6 says, "Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him." He provides spiritual food, spiritual nourishment for us. Later in the same chapter, Jesus said to the people, verse 53, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you." So what does this mean? Not physical, literal eating and drinking, nor the breaking of bread or Lord's Supper or communion, whatever you want to call it. No, but taking him by faith. To eat his flesh and drink his blood is to receive what the Bible tells us concerning the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the cross, his body was given up for us. His blood was shed for us. To believe him as the Son of Man, come from God and sacrificing himself in the death of the cross for us, is to eat his flesh and drink his blood. And so a sinner, a believing sinner, receives eternal life. Now that's once for all time. But there's a continuous side to this too. Verse 56 says, "He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him." That's the continuous side of this. We need to spend time with him, in communion with him, in prayer and reading of him in his word, in meditating on him. The expression feeding on him is used sometimes. What you eat gets absorbed and becomes part of you. We starve if we don't eat. Our spiritual lives starve if we don't feed on him. Okay, so those are my sections based on what the Lord Jesus says about himself as the Son of Man. Firstly, the deity of the Son of Man. He is God with divine power and authority. Secondly, the purpose of the Son of Man in coming to this earth. He came to serve. He came to seek and to save the lost. He came to give his life as a ransom. Then thirdly, we looked at the life of the Son of Man here on earth. He was a man, God's perfect man, who glorified God. He was an outcast, the rejected man. Then we saw the near future for the Son of Man, so his betrayal, suffering, death, resurrection. We noted where the Son of Man is now at God's right hand. We saw the Son of Man will come again, will judge and will rule after the church is taken and at the end of the tribulation period. And then we commented on our relationship with the Son of Man. We need to feed on him. We need to spend time reading, praying, meditating, reflecting on him. Obviously, there are many other scriptures that could have been quoted. Hopefully, these will give some ideas, some thoughts, and be helpful. Now, going outside the Gospels, we see the one man who spoke of him as the Son of Man. This was Stephen in Acts 7. Stephen was the only disciple to refer to the Lord Jesus as the Son of Man, and that was as he was dying, being stoned with stones, he saw the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God, not sitting there, but standing, presumably to welcome Stephen into his presence. As we noted earlier, the Son of Man is now at the right hand of God. Twice in Revelation, one like a Son of Man is seen. The same phrase was used in our prophecy from Daniel 7, clearly referring to the Lord Jesus. Daniel 7 tells us he'll have universal dominion. In Revelation 1:13, John saw one like a Son of Man among the lamps. The lamps are the Christian assemblies. In John 5:27, we learn that the Father has given Christ authority to execute judgment because he is the Son of Man. So he's seen here in Revelation 1 in a judicial point of view as a judge. It was a vision of the Lord judging in the middle of his assemblies. And in Revelation 14:14, we again find him like a Son of Man. Clearly Christ come to execute judgment on this rebellious world near the end of the tribulation period before he sets up his kingdom and rules with justice. But let's briefly return to Hebrews 2. We saw that the writer to the Hebrews quotes from Psalm 8 about the Son of Man. He notes that the one who is the brightness of his, that's God's glory, and the express image of his person, as he writes in chapter 1, verse 3, the Son of God became a man lower than the angels. There are additional beautiful and encouraging truths related to the humanness of the Lord Jesus, and they could be considered as coming in this context of the Lord Jesus as the Son of Man. I want to pick it up from verse 14. So let's just read a few verses from Hebrews 2, starting at verse 14. Hebrews 2:14. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For indeed, he does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. Therefore, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he's able to aid those who are tempted. So the Lord Jesus partook of flesh and blood, became human, that through death he might destroy the devil and his power over people. Additionally, the Lord Jesus, because he was here as a suffering man, being tested and tempted without sin, of course, because of this, he's able to help us when we're tempted and tested. I'm sure you experience this. He is wonderfully encouraging to us, isn't he? He's there for us in our trials. Okay, now there's a sense in which the Lord Jesus didn't need to use this title of the Son of Man. He could have said what he wanted to say with I. He could have said, I've come to seek and save that which was lost, and so on. He didn't. It's a common failing of us sinful human beings to distort the truth. The truth I'm referring to here is that the Lord Jesus is fully and completely God and is fully and completely human. This is difficult. You know, perhaps we could say impossible, really, for our finite minds to grasp. And it's been very common for religious leaders to distort the truth. Some have emphasized his humanness and rejected his deity. Some have emphasized his deity and not accepted his humanness. A common error nowadays is to maintain that Jesus was a good man, a true human being, but not God. Early in the church, the other error seems to have been quite common. There were some who maintained that although he was God, he couldn't have been truly human. In using his title of the Son of Man, the Lord Jesus is emphasizing time and time again that he truly is human. And we see too that he links the title to his deity, truly man, truly God. So to repeat myself in closing, if you'll forgive me, based on what the Lord Jesus says about himself as the Son of Man, we've seen the Son of Man is God with divine power and authority. The purpose of the Son of Man in coming to this earth, he came to serve, to seek and to save the lost, to give his life as a ransom. The life of the Son of Man here on earth, he was a man, God's perfect man, who glorified God. But he was an outcast, the rejected man, by the human race. We saw the near future for the Son of Man, his betrayal, suffering, death, resurrection. We saw where the Son of Man is now at God's right hand. We saw that the Son of Man will come again, will judge and rule. And that's after the church is taken at the end of the tribulation period. He will have universal rule. And we noted that we have a relationship with the Son of Man. We need to feed on him in reading, prayer, reflecting on him, spending time with him, meditating on him. Right, let's close this meeting in prayer.